Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's coverage here in Las Vegas for AWS reInvent 2024. It's our 12th year doing reInvent. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. Watching AWS' journey from 2023 to today has really been a historic kind of documentary, if you will, of just the innovation. But now we're on a whole nother level. What's happening with this, I call Gen 2 cloud. Amazon doesn't use that word, but I think it's Gen 2. Whole nother level, how software's going to be rewritten. Matt Garman mentioned that to me. And you're starting to see inference, all these new things point to a future that's not yet determined. The future's unwritten, it's being written now. Baskar, he's the Vice President of Machine Learning and AI Services for Infrastructure. Baskar, great to have you on
great
theCUBE.
Great to be here.
The future's unwritten right now, and the canvas is the new software emerging, and you're seeing that with everyone's excitement around Gen AI and essentially around agents. And I like how Swami kept at the end of his keynote, because it is coming, but there's a lot of good stuff happening in between then. We were talking before you came on around how SageMaker's dropped into the infrastructure level. Now Bedrock's a centerpiece for using that. The infrastructure stack has a little bit changed. Take a minute to explain kind of what's going on with the stack. What is infrastructure? What's model layer look like? And then kind of where does it stop and start? Where's the line?
Yeah, great question. And you know, happy to be on your show. I think if you look at where our customers are trying to understand how to move from data to analytics to model development to Gen AI application. And if you look at where the industry was prior to our announcements this week, they were siloed, right? There are siloed tools and services for data, there are siloed tools and services for analytics, there are siloed tools for model development. And then there is, you know, siloed services and tools for developing your Gen AI app and deploying them. But when we spoke to our customers, and this is the Amazon DNA, we speak to our customers and we walk backwards from our customers and what our customers want. And customers were really asking for a seamless way to move from data to analytics to model development to Gen AI app development. And how do you actually provide that comprehensive horizontal task completion in a seamless manner? And that takes us back to your question, which is, what does SageMaker become now? And so from our perspective, we are responding to our customers and we are saying SageMaker, the next generation of SageMaker, is the unified experience that will move our customers and help move our customers from data to analytics to model development and also to Gen AI app development, right? And so if you look at that, and you asked me a question about how do I think about the various layers of the infrastructure and where does one start and where does one stop?
Mm-hmm.
So let me walk you through that, given this background.
Yep.
The bottommost layer, the way we look at it now, has two parts to it. One is the actual hardware. And as you saw, we have our Trainium 2, our own silicon, and we are super excited about the price performance of that. That is part of the infrastructure piece. And now, the next generation of SageMaker encompasses the data, analytics, modeling, and AI, and that's now become an infrastructural component for our customers to create Gen AI applications, right? Mm-hmm. Now, if you go one more layer up and say, great, I have my model with my own data that was used to either customize the model by fine-tuning or by model distillation. You probably saw the model distillation announcement.
Yeah, I did.
On Bedrock. Models that are distilled on Bedrocks is 500% faster and 75% cheaper to run. Mm-hmm. And so that brings us to the next layer, which is the Bedrock for inference. We now consider Bedrock as the platform for inference workloads on AWS. And the key element here for us is how do we help our customers write and build their Gen AI applications while understanding that there's not going to be one model that rules them all. So if you take the clock back 2 years ago, maybe an 1.5 years ago, I think there was a feeling that there's going to be one model to rule them all. I'm going to choose the model and then build my applications and I'm done. Now, if you fast forward, you know, we had model A won the benchmarks. A few months later, it was model B, and then model C and model D. So this constant leapfrogging of models is now becoming a reality. So how do you help our customers build their GenAI applications while providing the model choice and also helping the customers move from one model to another? In fact, 97% of AWS customers use more than one model. And I don't know if you knew about that, but that's the very
We also heard from Andy Jassy on the keynote that internally, as you guys were experimenting with the models, there was diversity around model choice, even inside AWS before the announcements came out.
Exactly. And so that, I think, has now become a reality. So given that reality, how do we help our customers with the right set of services and tools for them to build their GenAI applications? And this is why some of the launches that we did today on Bedrock, whether it was model distillation, whether it was prompt caching, whether it's the fine-tuning of models, they all help to reduce the inference cost. Because inference cost is a very critical piece of going from prototype to production. And these tools and features we launched today help customers reduce and manage the inference cost. It's not just the inference cost, right? When you talk about cost, it's also the cost for training. And this is where the SageMaker HyperPod AI is very useful. The SageMaker HyperPod, you know, the training, the task governance, the flexible training plans, the recipes.
It's funny because I love the positioning because it brings that orchestration of the workloads. Because job completion is, at the end of the day, what you're striving for. And job completion is the KPI that everyone's kind of benchmarking around. So you don't want to actually redo a job that's been completed that you can offload. So all kinds of, there's so much complexity.
Complexity in dealing there. And we want to automate that. We want to make it extremely easy for our customers and make it cost efficient so they can actually go to market faster and at much cheaper training costs. So that's the training piece. So there's infrastructure, which is, you know, SageMaker plus the architecture, the hardware architecture. One more layer up gets you to Bedrock and the Bedrock features and capabilities for inference. Now, if you go one more layer up and you think of this and say, okay, if I'm in Bedrock, how do I build using the tools that Bedrock provides, whether it's knowledge bases, whether it's RAG, whether it's Bedrock guardrails, and we just announced automated reasoning that integrates with Bedrock guardrails that reduces hallucination, and whether it's a multi-agent collaboration, how do you build, use your all of these tools in Bedrock to build your GenAI application so that you can now go to production.
By the way, I love the multi-agent collaboration feature. I thought that was pretty hot. The automated reasoning checks are nice too. That kind of flows into that. So a lot of goodness is coming in. I love how RAG has evolved into not just search. It's a lot more going on.
The graph RAG.
Just point your structured data and graphs data at the graph and the structured data too.
Oh, that's another piece, right? Yeah. Like the graph RAG helps you connect various data sources together to augment your responses. There's the data automation piece that we launched where you can take unstructured corpus of unstructured data and create structured data with it, right? So,
before we get any further, I want to go down the rabbit hole a little bit with you on this because I want you to explain first what you do. You're a VP at Amazon, which means you get a lot of responsibility. Are you building the products? Are you building products and engineering? What specific things are you working on? What services? What's your focus?
Oh, great question. So the way I look at my charter is I'm responsible for Amazon SageMaker. I'm responsible for Bedrock. I'm also responsible for the data processing capabilities like Amazon's AWS's Athena, EMR, Glue. Mm-hmm. And then how do you actually bring
data? You get all the good stuff.
I have all the good stuff. So how do you bring and put them all together so that the data, the ML and the AI pieces all stand as one unified piece, which is what our customers have been asking for.
Yeah. So you have you're kind of a major part of the stack. So Dave Brown's got below you, so he's got the compute side. What I'm really interested in, what I was fascinated on my pre-interview with Matt Garma, he didn't give me the scoop, but he was pretty clear, and I thought I nailed it with the inference piece because I think what I heard there, and Werner was celebrating Lambda a couple weeks ago, 10th anniversary, and that's the serverless revolution. We saw that, and I'm like, when Matt said the databases and that inference is going to change the way software is written, the dots connected. Oh, Werner's on the serverless celebrate. Oh, serverless abstracted away servers in a way for developers with functions in Lambda. Oh, great stuff. Okay, inference is going to abstract databases because we've been saying on theCUBE for like almost 8 years, Dave, there's too many databases, but databases are great. You can have a lot of different data, time series for here, you got columnar store there, you got RDA relational, like whatever, database to do the job, not one database to rule the world. Sound familiar?
Yep.
So inference now is the interface to the developer.
Yes.
That will have a breakthrough for capabilities, just like serverless. No one knew what was going to happen next with serverless. So if you just take history with serverless and say, okay, put that into the inference side, that means the developer, I mean, every developer that was born, you know, there's not 20 or 15 today, has lived with a database. You don't write code without databases, yes, right? So we all know that. So now that's changed. They're living with inference.
Yes.
What is your vision on what that turns into? Because the game will change. It's still the same game. You're storing data somewhere, but it's being done for you. It's database less, I guess. I mean, but something's happening. Tell us, yes, what's your vision.
Yeah, great question. Let me split them into two parts. There's one where you have structured data. You, as you rightly called out, if I'm a GenAI app developer, I want the most easiest way to take my data and create a GenAI application. I don't want to worry about whether it's structured, unstructured, what do I do about unstructured, how do I manage the corpus of data that I have. So if I have a structured data, the structured data can also be made useful and integrated into Bedrock for your GenAI inference. That's number one. Number two is, I have unstructured data. Think of them as tables, images, videos, right? I have documents that have tables into them. How do I take this large corpus of data, transform them systematically into something that's valuable, and then integrate them into my application without having to worry about how I actually go build my pipeline to do it? If you remember,
yeah,
from the database world, people are talking about ETL.
Yeah.
So how do you do an ETL equivalent of it for GenAI, but without having to worry about and doing the heavy lifting that's required to move from unstructured to structured? And this is where the Bedrock data automation is going to play a very critical role,
mm-hmm,
because with a unified API call, you can now transform a corpus of this unstructured data into valuable data that you can now integrate very easily with inference. So your point is, I think the point that you start out with, which is, inference is now, think of this as the pinnacle that actually combines the work that you've actually done with data, the work you've done with models, and the work you've actually done with RAGs and knowledge bases and all of that, all come together. And how do you make it easy through APIs so that enterprise customers who are wanting to develop applications don't have to do the heavy lift?
Yeah,
I'm very excited by these announcements.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting too, because if you think about like infrastructure as code, go back to the early days of the cloud, that was DevOps.
And yes.
Yeah, I want to control the production environment because I'm building it. That created a revolution. Yeah, throw security in there, DevSecOps. And then you had the complexity of all this service and serverless. Now you have all this complexity around data. You mentioned formats, but this databases, that goes away for the developer. Now I'm the developer, I'm just coding. So, you know, you're going to have business as code, data as code. So the relationship to the developer becomes paramount. It was nice to see Matt Garman's first slide be about the heroes community, but his second sequence of his keynote was developers. Right, so again, another little tell sign there of kind of where the mindset is. This is going to have a huge impact on developers. Any vision for developers out there thinking about this, what could this turn into? Because this pinnacle is going to also be a service agent to the developer.
That's a fantastic segue. I love the way you actually got to this piece. Now, one of the things that I think is now becoming an inflection point in the industry is there's a realization that there will be agents which are very specifically designed to perform a single task. And you will have a multitude of these agents, and then you want to have an orchestrator who can take all these agents, orchestrate them to produce the final response to the customer. This is one more level up than me just writing a GenAI application. Right? Think of each agent as an application, right? Now you have a multiple of these agents. How do you put them together? Again, you know, with the Bedrock's multi-agent collaboration, we are making it extremely easy for customers to write multi-agent collaboration systems without having to do the heavy lift, right? And the interesting piece here is each agent is specifically designed to do a single task. But even again here, we want to make it extremely easy for customers to do it. We don't want them to be writing a lot of code just to get an agent out. So how do you make it easy and scalable?
So we're entering an era of personalization. So quick question for you. Within a year or 2 years, say 2 years, will agents be able to book my flight and my hotel going to New York and make the transaction for me? Under 2 years or greater than 2 years?
I think it'll be under 2 years.
Okay. Even with payments involved?
I think there will be...
Reservations, maybe.
Yes.
Payments.
Yes. I think the pace at which the industry is rapidly approaching production scale for agents, I think we'll be there.
Okay.
Because if you look at it, the agents impersonate, you know, if an agent can impersonate under authorized conditions for a user, then you can actually do the user's task. And so we are already there with some portions of it, like there are sparks of it with in the computer use that we launched recently in collaboration with Anthropic. These are actually all trends moving towards the place that you actually described.
Talk about the Anthropic relationship with the infrastructure, because what's coming out of the Trainium 2 and the Ultra servers that's being implemented, I mean, they're doing their job in Dave Brown's department, I got to say. They're doing good work. So, but people are writing down to the hardware level. And for the first time in theCUBE in the 15 years we've been doing, this is the only year, besides me saying the word assembler code, I've heard people talk about, I'm writing assembler, I'm at the kernel level. These aren't hardware engineers. These are ISV type. These are software developers. They're going down with the value extraction. So you see the SageMaker at this point of value, because you got orchestration, you got interface to infrastructure. SageMaker is becoming that interface to everything on below bedrock. So that's going to be a nice spot to like do some innovation. What's the developer angle on that? What's the focus for me if I want to extract value? I know Perplexity is going down to the low levels,
right?
Because squeezing every piece of performance and value out of the infrastructure.
Yeah, great question. The reason why we actually get down to the kernel level, for example, and even assembly, is you want to extract every single mileage that you can to reduce the cost of training or running inference on these workloads. That's the primary reason. And if you look at the SageMaker Unified Studio, the Unified Studio is essentially a unified environment, as I mentioned multiple times, which helps you move from data to developing your ML model or your GenAI model to building your GenAI application, right? And that, I think, is essentially how we are thinking of lifting up the abstraction level so that it's easier for developers to use this unified environment. For example, the Bedrock IDE is now integrated into the SageMaker Unified Studio. And that's a pretty interesting development.
Baskar, you got a hard stop. I could chew your ear off for another hour. We definitely picked this up and maybe in Seattle. Were you in Seattle?
Yes, okay, I am based out of Seattle.
You guys got a nice studio I used up there too. A good podcast studio up there. Let's pick it up there, but just end the segment with your vision for ML service at the infrastructure. What's the biggest change? Obviously, SageMaker people now may or may not know it's been positioned. But what's the vision of where the value is, how people can interface, what they should be doing, what should they be looking at? Share with us your vision.
Let me start with where we want to be. We want AWS to be the best place for customers to build GenAI applications. We want SageMaker, we want Bedrock, and we want the data processing capabilities that we launched to be the most easiest and the scalable way for you to get to market really quickly and very efficiently, whether you're trying to process data or whether you're trying to train and build a model or whether you're running inference. That is the vision.
Awesome. Well, thanks for coming on theCUBE. I know you're super busy. Thanks for taking time out of your busy schedule. Welcome to theCUBE. First time now part of theCUBE alumni.
Yes.
Family. Appreciate it.
Thank you. And as I said, I'm a fan of your show.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
Well, we're bringing all the action here. This is a CUBE factory here. We're bringing all the action here in Las Vegas. Our 12th reInvent. We've been covering the journey, and it's like a documentary. It's writing itself. So all the innovations here. I'm John Furrier with theCUBE. Thanks for watching.